Today, I went to Penton and the fire brigade had departed because I was called there yesterday and their fire brigade were there. There were 10 engines in attendance at Penton and they were doing a fine job. I must say the fire brigade were absolutely amazing. Everything about the way they were handling the situation was really excellent. We are lucky that we have people and equipment who just turn out at any time and get stuck into dealing with very dangerous and frightening situations, and they just treat it as part of their normal day. And their normal day started, of course, at 2 o'clock in the morning when they were called. So just to set the scene, I mean, I first discovered this when the phone rang, say that there had been a very significant fire. And so I went straight, dropped everything and went to Penton to be there really. And what confronted me was a most disappointing, I think it's the best way to put it, sight, which was that the whole area, including our unit, were pretty well destroyed. Nothing to see except the front walls, curiously. The rest of the buildings, no roofs, just ash everywhere and mess. I mean, it was an extraordinary sight. We couldn't get anywhere near the building to look inside at that point. But today, a day on, we're invited to go back there by both the BBC and the ITV, who wanted to feature this. We had issued, in the meantime, a press release explaining what had happened. I think it's fair to say that the moment we issued that release, we started an incredible response from people we knew, and people we know, and people who we don't know, from not just the local area, not just the bus preservation movement, but from all over the country and all over the bus business. People saying, we feel for you, folks. We know this is what we all dread. This is the most scary thing that we have to contend with, fire. That's been extraordinary, really. My emails and texts and my phone even have been running the whole time from the moment that we published the information. Concern, interest, worry, people just feeling with us for what had happened. But our great Olympic hasn't gone completely. So shall we put my stick in and have a look, see? We're going to take the lights down a bit so that you can see the pictures. So this is the view in through the accommodation door into the building. And the Olympic was in the middle. You can see on the left here, the front of the Bristol RE. It looks like a Bristol RE, doesn't it? Except it's got nothing behind it. To give a bit of a context, we're looking through the windscreen of the RE, and behind it is another RE. It's interesting that you see the chassis and the seats, basically all that survived. And here is the Olympic, looking more or less like a bus. To the right of it, a coach burnt out. Behind them should have been a whole lot of double-deck buses. Nothing at all. Just ash. It's extraordinary, isn't it? The Olympic itself, as you can see, let's take some more pictures. Here we have a wider view. You can see how the coach is gone. You can see how the roof, the only place in the whole complex where the roof wasn't burnt through, incredibly, was above the Olympic. The rest of the buildings, all five units, have no roof at all. You can see unit six beyond is starting to be improved. So we had this area around the Olympic where it was just a little bit less hot than everywhere else. This is the view down the side of the Volvo B10M Van Hall coach. Just got its MOT. The Olympic's on the left, we'll come to that. This is looking down the front of the Olympic. That's the chap from ITN. You can see that the blackened headlamps, the corner has been eaten away, but the rest of it is still there. This is the front offside wheel. Not much left of the tire there. Here's the radiator, which was previously behind the wheels, burst out, dropped onto the floor. You can see the frame. Yes, you can see it again. The framework is looking, in that bit, still quite complete. If you look along the side, 78 always had a bit of a sag on the right-hand side, but it's got rather more pronounced sag now. That's the driver's seat. You're looking across the bus at the front, down to the entrance doors. This is part of the framework. Here, and these are seat frames. The cushions are more, of course, have all gone. And this is looking back from the driver's cab through the vehicle. You look how the roof is sagging on top of it, and much of the near side has disappeared. But it's interesting that the seat frames are pretty well all there, and the one or two that we had made ourselves as part of the restoration have survived complete. The original ones have lost their tops. But it looks as though the flat of the surface is actually still relatively flat, so that's quite interesting. It's hard to make out what some of these pictures are, isn't it? Here we're looking across to the entrance doors from the front seat on the right-hand side behind the driver. Looking down through the driver's cab, I can see the handbrake here and the gear lever. It's lost its plastic top, of course. The steering wheel has lost its wheel, but has the center. And that's the plinth for the driver's seat. All these parts of the vehicle that were worked over in intimate detail from 2000 to 2012. And yet, offside front corner, there's still a bit of glass in it. It's pretty well the only piece of glass in the whole complex, literally. And down the side, the offside, next to the Bristol RE, looking down the side between the coach and the Olympic. And here we're looking up through the first bay onto the driver's seat. So here's the driver's seat here again. Here's the steering wheel. Here's the front windscreen here. And here is the side window, and there's the mirror, look, so it's ready to go. A little bit of fixing. And look at the seat frame in front of us. It looks square and well-placed and everything else, doesn't it? You can see, therefore, that it's very, very extensively damaged. So the question is it finished? I was 10 in 1966. This bus, JAA 708, finished its operational life in Winchester. It had spent 16 years working for King Alfred Motor Services, mainly, but not always, running on the number 4 route up Romsey Road to Stanmore, for which it wasn't really very well suited. It had a very large 0600 Leyland engine, and it was a little overpowered for the purpose. But nonetheless, it was used every half an hour, every day, to run up Romsey Road, most days. So it had disappeared, and I didn't come onto the King Alfred scene till I was 13, 14, something like that. I was really taking notice. The Olympic had disappeared, it had gone. Now, Most King Alfred buses went for scrap, but this one, unusually, was part exchanged for something else, and consequently it went to a dealer's called Baker West in Farnham, and they sold it, quite unexpectedly, to a buyer in the Republic of Ireland, in a place called Craig na Spidaug, which is more or less in the centre of the island of Ireland. And there it was bought by a chap called Jimmy Glynn, and he used it as a school bus for about 10 years. Painted red, a few alterations made to it, but generally the same vehicle. And at that point, all went cold. So all of a sudden now, we fast forward to first running day of 1990. A chap sidled up to me and said, "I know where JAO 708 is." And I said, "You mean the Olympic?" "Yes," he said, "I know exactly where it is. And furthermore, I could take you there." A few months later, a group of FOCAB members took the ferry from Fishguard to Rosslare, and we were met and taken to Jimmy Glynn's yard, where extraordinary cornucopia, really, of abandoned buses and coaches lying in a field. And there in the corner of it was JAA 708, the very vehicle you can see behind me, in an advanced state of dilapidation, been there for 10, 12, 15 years, I don't know quite, and no one had looked at it in that time. And we were able to negotiate the purchase for £1,000 in sterling, as Jimmy Glynn said, and in due course, the vehicle was towed by a Ford Transit on a chain to the ferry port, and eventually, in 1993, it sailed across the Irish Sea to Fishguard, was put on a low loader, driven to Hampshire. And that started our ownership of this vehicle. But the irony of it was that just then, another vehicle, POU 494, a Leyland Titan double-decker, appeared from America. And FOCAB had to decide what to do. And the decision was, we'll do the Titan and we'll leave the Olympic for the time being. It was basically under a tarpaulin, standing out in the open, and left while we got on with other things. The story of JAA 708, our Leyland Olympic, continues in the second episode. The story of JAA 708, our Leyland Olympic, continues.